Now, I've made the test with some students not from management, and they told me that they have understood, and so I can speed up a bit. Now, do you agree? Now, we have passed 2 hours in telling you that you need to mark in your head that the objective function of a profit company is the economic value, the generation of cash for the long run, and the formula is the net present value. Now that you have learned this, we undermine the formula, because this formula is very good, is very precise, but unfortunately, when we have complex context, we have a lot of difficulties in measuring the cash flow, the investment, the specific lines from now to infinite. When we have this situation, we need to find alternative measures. This is a complex situation. This is a map of the transportation system providers in Milan. I apologize with people from Torino. What do you see here in the Lombardy, not only in Milan? What do you see here is the circle are service operator. In the Milan City Council, as you can see, we have only one operator. Do you know who is the operator? ATM. Then we have other two operators in the Milano province. We have one in the Brescia. We have a lot in Bergamo. Brescia and Lecco. All these bubbles are providers, business companies who provide transportation. Some years ago, the Lombardy region, who aggregate all these companies, decided, not spontaneously, but just because there is a law, that they needed to integrate their services. So it means that ATM now need to look at all the other providers to find ways to integrate their services. When we have this situation, we have one company, if you are ATM, which need to agree with other business companies which want to make money, which need to agree with different level of the public sector, the region and the province. When we have this complex situation and we are evaluating two different alternatives for integrating the service, the transportation service, calculating how much cash can I generate from one alternative and how much cash can I generate from another alternative is not so easy. It's not so easy, and as you have seen with Bruno, it's not so easy because we have different people who want different things. If I am the public sector, the Lombardy region, I want the integration. I want to demonstrate to the European Union that in Lombardy we have a good integrated service. If I am a province, which is a tiny level within the public administration, a sub-level within the region, I want to demonstrate that I have a very good integrated service in my province. If I am ATM, what do I want? ATM is the service provider, business company. What do you want? Autonomy. But at the end, why do we want autonomy? We want to make money, always. For us, as ATM, as business company, we go for a solution when this solution increases the cash that we can generate. But what happened? My solution as business company can be different from the solution of the Lombardy region, because they don't look at the cash that is generated for service providing. There is a further problem, which is the problem of the integration of transportation. There are no clear solutions. There are many ideas, many bits, but there are no clear solution for the integration of transportation. When we are in this type of situation, making the forecast in different years of the cash flow is not so easy. Because how can be very precise in telling, okay, I will sell these tickets and this client will provide the money, this will provide the money in the next year, when we don't have a clear idea of the transportation configuration? When we have this situation, we move, we don't calculate directly the net present value, but we use proxies, as you have seen with Giovanni. Two alternative measures. There are many. On one side, we have something which is very rough, not very precise, which is return on investment. We don't tackle this today, but tomorrow morning. On the other side, which is, there is something which I like very much, which are key performance indicators. So when we are in uncertain, complex situation, this calculation is very difficult. So company very often goes for these two roads: return on investment or residual income. On the other side, key performance indicator. Now, for your nights, but not for now, this is what is called the value tree, which try to put together everything. Here you see the net cash flow, our cash. How can we generate our cash? Selling products and doing investments. Then we have sales from product, new product, production cost. Okay, but how can I increase or control that I'm generating sales and cash, looking at the customer satisfaction? In the very last element, we have the key performance indicator. We will tackle this tomorrow. Before moving to the impact evaluation, just a specification on a term that maybe you have found also in journals, maybe Il Sole 24 Ore, Financial Times. This is your usual reading every morning, I'm sure. Which is EBITDA, EBITDA. Have you ever heard? This is a label which is used usually in meetings. Also when you are new in a company, if you participate in a meeting in which numbers, financial numbers are discussed, they talk about, and it happened to me, EBIT and EBITDA. Actually, the labels that were taught to me during my university study were very different. So when I heard EBIT or EBITDA, I was a bit confused. So we try to understand what do we mean. We said that profit is revenues minus cost, equal to profit. This was a sort of approximation because we didn't take into account the financial activity. These are the revenues for selling products, these are the cost for buying material, and we get the profit. Actually, the profit is the very last row in our picture, because a complete profit and loss account, this statement is called profit and loss account. I apologize for non-Italian, but I just make a translation. For Italian who studied economia, this is conto economico. for other people. Profit and loss account is called in other legislation also income statement, because we have US and UK. Sometimes they disagree on terms, but they are the same things. In the profit and loss account, what do we find? Revenues minus operating cash cost. Operating cash cost are when we buy something and we pay immediately. So it means cash outflows. The difference between operating cash cost and revenues is called earnings before interest, taxes, depreciation and amortization. What is depreciation and amortization? Who knows depreciation? Good. Management people. Do you know? Good. Do you know what is depreciation? Ammortamento? Okay, good. We have revenues by selling products, 1,000. We have operating cash cost, buying lemons. Suppose 300. These generate the EBITDA, 700. We have other costs which are not a cash outflows. I give you an example. Within this operating cash flow, we have the lemons, but we don't have the table, because the table is used for more than 1 year. We don't see the table, the cost of the table, within the operating cash cost. But we want to account, because we are paying the table. The way to account in the profit and loss account for the cost of the table is using the depreciation. The depreciation is a fake, is just a calculation, is not a real cost, which is related to fixed assets. The table. Suppose we buy a very nice table in 2012 for 2,000 euros. And we are going to use the table for 10 years. Okay? So we are going to pay 2,000 today, and we use the table for 10 years, which is the cash outflows, outflow for the table, 2,000, which is the cost related to the use of the table? Very good. You have divided to define the cost for 2012. You have divided 2,000, the value of the table, by 10, and you find 200. What you have done is the calculation of the depreciation. So the depreciation is 200. Which will be the depreciation in 2013? 200. 14? 200. This until 2022. Okay? There are different ways I can examples say. I want to say that the first year the value is higher, so I put 300 the first year and then 200 in the other. But our governments prefer this very simple linear mode. Just the value of an asset divided by 10. If you think at big company, an asset can be a nuclear plant, so not a table. What we need to do is just the same. We understand, we calculate the value of the plant. We divide by the number of years that we are supposed to use the nuclear plant, and we insert the yearly cost. This is called depreciation. Taking away amortization and depreciation, this non-cash cost, we arrived to EBIT, earning before interest, which means the interest that we pay to the banks, taxes. In our case, is 500. Now we have another bit. Yes? I wanted to avoid, but you made the question. Depreciation, we have, first, we have different type of assets. We have assets that we can touch, the table. This is called tangible assets. Then we have assets which are a value for the company for some years that we cannot touch. An example of intangible asset are patents, brevetti. Patents are some are related to the development of innovation that we buy, and for example, for producing a cancer medicine, we buy the patent, also aspirina, as a very traditional and common medicine has a patent. We buy the patent and we produce the medicine. When we buy the patent, we buy the right to produce this product. And we have an asset. It's just a piece of paper, but the value is intangible. Another example of intangible assets is the brand. Suppose you can buy the brand of Coca-Cola. You have a great value because you buy the brand and you buy the formula. In this case, it's something which is not tangible, you cannot touch, but it's there and you can produce money from this value. When we talk about tangible, the table, assets, we talk about depreciation. When we do the calculation for intangible assets, we call amortization. So it's just the meaning is the same, but they are referring to different types of assets. In the Italian legislation, we use one word, ammortamento, for both the labels. Okay? This is just a different for international standards.
When you said 10 years for the table, this is also, how do we determine? Because maybe it can last more or it can break in 5 years.
Yeah, I translate the question, no, just because they don't hear not the language. Is she asked, okay, you said we have a table for 2,000 euros. You said we are using for 10 years. The calculation is very clear, but how did you determine the 10-year of the life of the table? This is called the useful life of the table. It's the horizon of time in which you are going to use the table. The table can be used for 10 years because you know that after 10 years it will have problems. Or just because you know that after 10 years you are going to do something different and you need a different table. So the useful life can be related to the specific life of the table or just because you change your activity. Suppose that this is my table, but I'm improving my activity and within 5 years I will need a different table, larger. The useful life of this table will be 5 years and not 10. Although this table can last in terms of material for 10 years.
Okay. Especially when we're talking about technology, we can't presume, it's more a presumption of how long we are going to use.
Yeah.
If a guarantee list can help us.
They are asking, okay, for the table again is simple. what happens if we have technology? This is a problem. I don't know, I did my thesis, my master thesis in textile, because I'm management engineer, but with specific field in textile companies. And when I did my master thesis, the technology for printing tissues was totally different from the technology which is used now. And I'm not so old, so I graduated in 99. So in 1999. So within less than 20 years, we had this change, a big change. When I did the thesis, the technology, the plants for producing this material for printing had a useful life of 30 years. Unfortunately, this was a prediction, a forecast, which proved to be wrong, because actually this technology now is old. The useful life of this printing machine was shorter than 30 years. So what we can do now is to do, as for the cash flow, our best forecast, trying to find sources to see, I'm buying a technology. Are there other technology which are under development? And so it is very likely that within 5-10 years we need to change. We need to make this analysis. But unfortunately, always we have uncertainty. When we make a forecast, be ready that if you come out with a number, this number will be never the real, the actual number. You have always mistakes. It's part of the forecast. As I say, make a forecast of your average. Are you at the first year of your Master of Science? Second. Make a forecast of your graduation mark, final mark. Can you? Very precise. Just guess. I'm sure you have an idea. Make a guess of the mark of your friend, so it's not so personal. 110. She said 110. But this can be, I don't know, very certain, because she's going to graduate in April. She knows that she cannot get the laude because, I don't know, are you from Milano or Turin? Milan, so she knows that she cannot get the laude because she cannot get 113. And she knows that she has a good thesis and at least she will get 110. If she is, for example, in a situation in which she misses four exams, she needs to work on the thesis. In this situation, there are many variables. You can find a very hard professor, which will undermine your average. And you have 28, 29, and you go down to 27. And something happened to your thesis, and you don't do a very good job, and you don't get 7, but you get 3. This can happen. This is a forecast. We try to do forecast, but it's forecast, because there are a lot of variables affecting. Sometimes uncontrollable. Suppose that something happened and a company, are you meeting McKinsey today?
No, BCG.
BCG comes to you and say, come with us and we will give you 100,000 euros per year, net. But you need to come to us tomorrow. What do you do? Sorry? What do you do?
Speak with Franco Bernelli.
In this situation, some people can choose not to leave, but to graduate very soon with lower mark, because BCG is asking for you, and they are providing you 100,000 euros per year. In this case, an unlikely, I don't say if it's a good or bad event happen to you, and you are changing your plan and your forecast. This can happen every day. We have opportunity and risk. We can decide to take risk and opportunity, but our forecast can change. When we have this, we take away the financial expenses, which are the interest that we pay to the bank. We add the financial incomes that can be generated by investing in other companies, in bond security. And then we take away the taxes. And these are extraordinary activities. These are the lines to arrive to the profit. We have been very rough in considering just revenue and cost. This is a complete profit and loss account. And these are the labels EBIT and EBITDA that you will hear very often in company. Our focus today, tomorrow, but very commonly also in the discussion in real life are in the upper part, in the operational part. The financial part is so specific, so technical, that has become a business of financial units, finance organizational units. So this is a problem that we don't have usually to take into account. Now, the key terms. Net present value, net cash flow, cost of capital, earning before interest and taxes, earning before interest, taxes, depreciation and amortization. Finally, something that we will tackle tomorrow, key performance indicator. These are six labels that it's better you remember, because people sometimes in meetings say NPV, not net present value or the objective of the company. People say EBIT, people say EBITDA, cost of capital is usually say cost of capital, and another label you will say KPI, key performance indicator. So it's just some term that is better you know. But now we start the nice part. The part in which usually we have more ideas from people, not from management, but from other fields. Because people from management think at the formula, net present value. And instead, the people from different fields are not so much used to net present value, and so they have a more open mind. In this part of the lesson, what we are going to do is to analyze which are the steps in making the evaluation and which are the drivers for evaluating the competitive impacts of our alternative. The first part will be quicker because you have tackled this partially with Professor Azzone. And these are the steps that we are going to tackle. The first part look at defining the alternatives of our decision. When we are going to make the integration of the transportation service, we have many ways. Can you just guess a way for integrating transportation in Milano, in Lombardy region, or in Piemonte region?
Train and trucks.
Train and bus. You can, an integration can be in terms of tariffs. If you have just one ticket that you can use on bus, trains, and all the other transportation, this is an integration which is very good for a user. But we have another. We can do the integration of information. For me, I live in a small village on Lake Como, another lake. And I move from Como to Milan nearly every day. So what I need to do is to take the train and sometimes the bus. For me, having information in Como on the situation of the traffic of the bus in Milan would be very useful. This is the integration of information. What does it mean, integration? Many things. You can do whatever you want. But different alternatives will reach different satisfaction for the different actors involved in the system. Again, go back to Bruno. They say, we look for the satisfaction of actors. We have the business company, we have the citizen using the services, we have the public administration. The first part is aimed at defining the alternatives. After we have defined the boundary of the alternative, we need to identify which are the benefits of the alternative you have analyzed, the impact. And then we calculate. Finally, we have the difficulty. Suppose you have chosen the alternative, you have decided that you go for the information integration. Good, you have your plan, you have your strategy, now you need to implement. And implementing a decision means going outside, choosing your strategy, again Bruno, but we need to tackle also with the internal context, because you are taking the decision and you are, for example, the top management, but the implementation of the decision rely very often on dozens of people. And you need to enroll these people in your decision. Otherwise, you will not arrive to what you want to obtain for your decision. So these are our steps. We start with the definition of the alternative. First of all, I think you have tackled with Giovanni Aldo quickly that a first analysis that you can do when you want to make a decision is to keep in mind that you need to start, you need to identify a baseline, a base case. A base case is a situation which is used to compare different alternatives. We take an example which is very near to you. I hope nobody from the out is listening to us. Suppose we want to find, to reposition this hotel. And now this hotel is used for conferences, for meeting like this, for tourists and so on. Suppose I give you the mandate, decision to improve the hotel and to increase the revenue. Is this a mandatory investment or is a not mandatory investment? Are you obliged to do something or can you continue to go on with the actual, the present management of the hotel? Actually, it's not mandatory. It's not mandatory because it seems to be a good revenue position. They have you, they have other conferences. So they seem to have no problem in dealing. They can continue with this situation. In some cases, we need to be very careful in this situation because let's say we are doing well, we have enough revenues, so what we do is no investments. So it means we do not invest in refurbishing, in doing additional services for the hotel. What can happen is that your net cash flow now is here, but if you don't do investment, in few years, your net cash flow can go down. So you need to be very careful. When you are in a situation when you don't have mandatory investment, very often companies just take the net cash flow of 2012 and they say, okay, this will be the net cash flow for future year. they do the actualization, they are very good in the calculation, but they do not take into account that we are not in this situation, but we are in this. Suppose this hotel decide that they do not do any type of adjustment in furniture, in everything, for 10 years. What will happen? This hotel will be out of the market in 10 years because they do not do the refurbishment. This is very dangerous. We are in instead a situation in which the investment is mandatory. And I think Giovanni underlined this very well because he did with me when I was a student, is an investment is mandatory not because it's mandatory by law. Of course, if it is mandatory by law, we need to do. But sometime we must do an investment just because we will be totally out of the market. This is, for example, the case of green products, but moreover, green plants. If we don't do investment in this type of activities, in 5 years, you can be out of the market. So it's very important to consider not the mandatory statement in terms of juridically regulation, but in terms of economic regulation. There is another benefit. Suppose that you don't consider investing in good in green product as mandatory. When you make the evaluation of two green products, you make the evaluation of three alternatives. The baseline current products, suppose I don't know, shampoo. A shampoo which is a green friendly, and another type of shampoo. One is more costly, one is less costly. In this case, you have the baseline and you have two green product alternatives. When we analyze these three alternatives, we have to evaluate a larger set of critical success factors. If I have a green shampoo, I need to evaluate which will be the impact on our customer of having a green product. In a situation in which we consider investing in green products mandatory, the evaluation of the two alternatives for the two different green products, green shampoo, are not evaluated in terms of image because they will be very similar in terms of external impact. So for us, evaluating the difference in image is not useful. And you will see this is related also to green product, inflows from traditional product that will be eliminated. So we have less variable to be analyzed. When instead we consider non-mandatory, we need to enlarge our pocket of variable. When we have defined this first step, we know if the investment is mandatory or not, and how many alternatives we need to evaluate. We have another problem in complex decision making. Sometimes it's very difficult to define the boundary of our investment. Suppose we are evaluating, as you will do tomorrow, because one of the cases will be green move, is you will evaluate. There is a reason the director is part of the project, so he choose green move for this reason. Is you are evaluating the introduction of electric car. When you want to introduce electric car in Torino, in Milano, it's not enough to evaluate the investment or buying cars because you have a lot of other linked investment. For example, I want to use electric car in Milan or in Torino. I need electric car. This is an investment. What do I need? Recharging. Where do you recharge? So we have the recharging infrastructure. Other.
Electric grid investment.
Sorry?
Electric grid investments.
Electric grid investments. We can, something that is forgotten, is the management of the network. And you need to think about this. And this is another investment. So if you enlarge, you need to, sometime you end up with an unfeasible project. So you need to understand which are your boundaries. You need to have, obviously, what is needed, because the electric car alone is not enough. But don't think at a huge project with changing the city of Milan, because otherwise you will never start your investment. And I work on a project which was an attainable project. Which was the construction of a cultural district. What is a cultural district? Do we have someone from architecture? I know. Do you know what is a cultural district? I work on this project 5 years and still I have some doubts on what is a cultural district. But it should be a geographical area in which economy and culture work together, and we make the most of the value of the culture. This is very vague, but this is what was asked by the financier. In this general label, we put a lot of ideas, which move from building a museum, from building tourist card, from making intangible re-evaluation of path and so on across the mountains. At the end, we had 50 different projects which were all together in the cultural district. The end of the cultural district was the failure of the cultural district, because we were not able to make the unbundling, to find the good project within the 50. We maintain the all 50 projects as a unique for the cultural district, and this was the failure, because it was unattainable. Because for this cultural district, we needed 15 million euros, and the generation of economic value was very uncertain. And so the financiers say, no, we do not finance this kind of project. So this is very important for complex projects, especially when you have private and public organization together. Finally, boundaries are not only in terms of scope of the project, but are also in terms of organizational, functional unit within the company. Because when you evaluate even a simple investment like the introduction of a new product, the introduction of the new product will tackle researcher in the conceptual phase, will tackle designer, will tackle engineers during the engineering phase, will tackle the production unit, because you are going to produce on a mass scale your products, the logistic, because you need to deliver the products, and also the marketing and selling, which is not included. So what you need to analyze, finally, when you have the external consistency, is also the internal consistency. Which units are affected by your innovation? And again, you are young, but at the very beginning, Amazon, do you know Amazon? Was very successful, but it happened on a specific Christmas that they sold a lot of books, but they were not able to deliver because they were not prepared on the logistical level. This was a bad decision management because they were able in production, in the marketing, in the idea, but they were not prepared on the logistics. Fortunately, Amazon is still there, so they were able to recover and they are still there. These errors can be killers for the company. Sometimes the market cannot sustain this error and you are out of the market. So there are many examples of this type. So with these three steps, we have now the alternative. Now you have the alternative. You need to understand the competitive impacts of your alternative. Andrea, can I give you a task? At 5:25, can you give me a signal? What does it mean, analyzing the competitive impacts? We have our alternative. And suppose we want to make a refurbishing of this hotel. And we want to evaluate two different alternatives. Alternative one is for an exclusive hotel, luxury. Alternative two, young people, sport. These are our target clients, and we are evaluating the repositioning of this hotel into different targets. High-class hotel, so we need to have some type of rooms, or we go for younger clients. This is very different. In these two cases, what we need to do is to analyze, taking as baseline the present situation, and you know the hotel because you are living here for a few days, which are the impacts in terms of external image from clients and internal management. Because, of course, if we go, for example, on a luxury hotel, you will need to change the room, but not only. Because in this type of hotel, what do clients expect? Services, for example. Yeah, the sauna, something like this. And instead, if I go for sport younger hotels, what do you expect? Playground. Sorry? Playground. Playgrounds.
Disco.
Disco. Do you expect guides? Yeah, which are guiding you, I don't know, in the landscapes and so on. In the mountain, this is very appreciated, especially if you are young, but not a specialist of alpinism and so on. So we need to have additional services. But in this case, we need people, we need to prepare our internal infrastructure. When we talk about impact, we want to analyze which are the critical success factor for these two alternatives. And we divide, we have our alternative, luxury and sport, and we have the external perspective, which means which are the critical success factor for getting the clients, and we have the internal impacts, which are the critical success factor for reducing the cost or just to be more flexible in our management. We now analyze these two bits, the external critical success factor and the internal. Obviously, what we see are general classification of typical success factor. But when you analyze the luxury hotel, you need to make a market analysis to see what is around, what the client wants, so to be very specific. So what I can provide you are guidelines, but not the answer. The answer comes only from a specific market and internal analysis. Starting from the market critical success factor, we talk about market drivers. Market drivers affect the revenues. When we talk and when you think about market drivers, you need to think at which are the elements, the dimension, which will increase your revenues. And in the two specific options, luxury and sport. And the revenues can be increased in two ways. Revenues are in terms of the hotel, the number of clients, times the fee that you pay, the price. How can we increase our revenues? Increasing the number of clients or increasing the price, or both, a mix of the two. So when we evaluate our drivers, we need to evaluate what can increase or the price or our number of clients. And we have, what we need to do is to evaluate the impacts, then something which is a bit more boring, getting the number, and then making a synthesis with net present value or other measure. For the market driver, we have four main elements. We can improve our quality, we can improve our service and range, we can improve our capability to respond quickly to our customer, or we can be environmentally friendly. Obviously, some of these variables can be applied to the hotel, other not. We start from the quality. What does it mean, product quality? With a product or a service quality, we need to, first of all, to the quality of the design. Suppose we are evaluating a new car. A new car is made of a lot of components and a lot of function. One function which is very important is the security of the car. Or if you like going at a high speed, it's also the speed of the car. These are functions which are taken into account when we do the design of a car. We can compare two different cars, comparing the impacts, sorry, the quality of the design. But then we have another problem. Suppose we have a very good car, a Toyota, but then we don't want just a very good design. We want that every unit that we produce is equal to the other, is reliable as the other. Not only a good design, but conformance to the design. Do you have a mobile phone? Did you, had you ever had problem with your mobile phone? Yeah. Yeah, I changed, I think not so many, but 5 mobile phones. And I was quite lucky because only once I had a problem with my mobile. And this mobile had the problem of conformance. it was a Nokia. Everyone was happy about that phone. And this was the reason why I bought this phone. But then my specific phone had a failure. And so I went to the shop 6 times. Then I decided to change the phone. This was not a problem of the quality of the design, because the function was very good. I can make my mobile, but sometimes it stops. In this case, we had the problem of conformance. For some products, this is crucial. There is a small company that I think you know in Como, which is called Eldor. Eldor produces pencil coils for cars. These pencil coils are an important component. For this company, which are provider of large automotive companies, the conformance is the most critical success factor. Because if there is only one piece which is which fail, they will have a problem, a big problem with all the other. So the company, the automotive company, can decide to change the provider. So for them, it's a critical success factor. For the hotel, the conformance can be more or less important according to the client. When you have a luxury service, a luxury client, usually you pay a lot, and so you expect a lot. If you don't receive the service that is written in what you paid, in the marketing brochure and so on, you get very angry. And you pass the word to your friend, don't go to this hotel, because the quality of the service is different from what is written in the brochure. If you are a 20-year-old guy or a 25-year-old girl, and you go in a hotel with some expectation that is an hotel open to sport, young, and so on, you are ready also to a less quality in conformance. So the importance of conformance is higher here than here. But if you are a young and sport activity guy, maybe for you the range of services provided is more important than for a person which who wants just to relax in a luxury environment. So the second set of variables can be important. And we have additional services, for example, a boat trip in some dangerous type of facilities. We have also the product or service variety. Sometimes we have also an embodied service. Do you cook by yourself or do you live in family? Who live alone? Good. Do you use frozen food?
Yes.
This is a service embodied in the product, because you can keep the food for 3, 6, sometimes I forget, it stay in the fridge for 1 year, but it's not suggested. This is an embodied function for your products. Then we have another element, which is the time. We can capture more clients because we are quicker than other competitors. In which type of companies this can be a critical success factor? Sorry?
Courier
service, very good. Also all the logistics. In all the logistic business, time is crucial. For other company, time is an important variable, but is not so crucial. This is the time for delivering current products. We have another important element of time, which is important. Suppose that we want to produce a new car, and we take 10 years to conceptualize, design, engineer, produce, and sell. What happened? The car is old. We adjusted the design, but you know better than me, because the majority of you are architect, engineer, but also designer, know very well. Is if we start the conceptualization of a project, of a product in 2012, and we finish and sell in 2020, very likely it will be old. We make adjustments, but usually are not very good. So time is not only important in delivering the existing products, but it's very important also when we design and develop new products. This is another critical success factor. When we look at the final element of the external impacts, we move to something which is different according to the geographical area. While the first elements are in some way, we have differences, but all want quality, service, timelining services, and so on. This last element look at the environmentally friendliness of our customer. So we need to analyze if our target customer look at the environment as an important dimension. For example, if you look at the hotel, do you think this is a variable taken into account by clients? You will say yes. Young. So if you have young, you will say environment. For luxury? Usually when we go in the luxury world, we are in the world of extra waste. So maybe the environmentally friendliness is not the most important factor. For some business is instead very important. And it's very important in terms of production processes and not only in terms of product that we produce. There is another phase, which is the social friendliness of our companies, which is not only to be friendly to the environment, which means emission, green products, and so on, but also to treat well the world, the society. And the society means that, for example, we don't use children for producing our goods. Do you have example of a large company who had problem? The 5 minutes. Okay. Do you have example of a company? Nike. Nike in the past, as many years ago, they had problems because it was discovered that they were using children to produce football balls in, I don't remember in which country. This was a big challenge in terms of image. Now, all the big companies are very careful. But again, how much do I need to push on this dimension? It depends on our clients, on our stakeholder. We need to look at this variable and to understand how much are we ready to invest, because this can be a market driver, okay? Finally, just this is, we look at the internal driver in 2 minutes and we will look in detail tomorrow. When we move from the external market to the internal analysis, we don't think what do our client want, but how can we do our activity in the best way, spending less money as possible? And what we look are the productivity of our processes. For example, if we look at a hotel, to have the less number of waiters with the same service at the tables. The flexibility, for example, to use the same person at the reception desk and at the IT desk. The process quality, which is related more to manufacturing activity, but we can see also the process quality in a hotel, for example, in cleaning the rooms. And then we have also, for the internal part, time and environmental compatibility. We look at these drivers tomorrow morning, okay? Enjoy your evening. Thank you.